first off, a big congratulations to everybody. You have made it to the last talk of the summit. And I had this whole thing prepared for you saying, can we finish early? But at least I'll try and finish on time. And I am going to be making a little bit of a contrast between a lot of the stuff that's been talked about so far, which is very much you have unstructured data, and from this unstructured data, you're trying to extract useful things and make cool predictions and so on, and to contrast it with the setting where you have structure in the data, and then you're trying to do some form of collective, scalable reasoning, which I'll unpack in this talk. But again, to start at a kind of high level, you know, we all know we're in the age of big data, the tsunami of big data, the avalanche of big data, you know, it's always some sort of natural disaster. And one point that I want to make is that a lot of that data is not flat. And some of it is sensor data, image data that has a flat structure, but big data is often not flat. It's often multimodal, multi-relational, spatial-temporal, multimedia, and even that raw sensor data often has some kind of structure that you may be able to exploit as well. And so, one of the things that I think is interesting about a lot of current AI methods is they tend to kind of take this nicely structured graph data and they flatten it and put it into some sort of table and then they apply their methods. Unfortunately, then they oftentimes spend a lot of time trying to extract that structure again from this flat data. And so when you have that structured data, I think we need methods that can exploit it. So I think we do need machine learning methods that can take as input structure, the graphs. And so if you're a big data fan and you know the V's of big data, we need another V beyond volume, velocity, variety, and so on that captures this kind of graph structure. And I actually got one of these from some folks at Penn State, Vinculate. So that means the ties between things, so the relational structure that is in the data. And so in this talk, there's not much time. I want to go over very briefly some patterns to go into using graph data, some key ideas that I think are applicable across a broad range of different methods that make use of graph data, and then briefly some tools. So for patterns, I want to talk about kind of the really simple patterns that are important to think about when you have graph data. And the first one that I'm going to go over is entity resolution. And entity resolution is a simple idea of determining the right nodes in the graph. And I'm going to give my favorite example of illustrating the issue with this. The following is actually a little teeny fragment from a real data set where the nodes are authors and the links are co-authorship links. And if you look at it even just for a little bit, you start seeing that there's actually a fair amount of issues in the data. And if you go through this process of kind of merging the nodes that are actually referring to the same underlying author, you end up getting the graph up here on the right, and compare that with the original graph that's on the left. And really think about it. If you apply any kind of algorithm to the first graph, having not correctly done this process, if you look at node degrees, if you look at pathways, if you do any other kind of feature construction, you're going to get completely bogus answers. And so one thing that I do want to admonish everybody, you know, if you're working with graph data, really think hard about whether or not you have have this property in their data because it's very important to correct for. You know, this is a simple example, but there actually are real results where people have gotten incorrect scientific results from not having done this resolution properly. Okay, so that was the first kind of micro pattern that you have to, when you're working, even when you have input graph data, you have to first do this process of figuring out what are the real nodes in your graph. The next problem, again, simple kind of problem, is link prediction, which is, okay, now that you have the nodes, infer the links. You know, this is a lot like recommendation, so I'm going to kind of predict the link between a user and an item, for example. But let me try to illustrate, again, with a little toy example, a slightly more complex case where what we have as input is a graph, so a communication graph, where we have links between individuals. And so we have observed set of communication relationships, but then what we're trying to output is a different kind of semantic link. So we're trying to output something about, you know, who works for who, whose colleagues, and so on. So it's interesting with graph data where you can have one kind of link that's observed and another kind that you're trying to predict, or potentially you're trying to predict the missing links that have not been observed. Then the last, again, micro pattern to mention is collective classification. Collective classification is simply the idea of inferring labels for nodes in graphs. And again, a simple little example, on a social network, I have a bunch of different kinds of relationships, and what I'm trying to do is label the nodes according to their political persuasion. And typically, the way this works is that you have some labels given, so you have some observed labels, and then you have a set of unknowns that you're trying to jointly infer. Okay, so these are simple patterns. Actually, really my favorite pattern is something that I call graph identification, where you really try and do all of these things at once. So you have some input noisy observational graph data. From that, you're trying to infer out a graph structure, and then that graph structure is the thing that you then are going to do your science on. So as an example of that, again, going back to the communication network, maybe I have an email communication network, and what I'm trying to get out is a social network or an organization hierarchy. So the kinds of things that would go into that would be, I'd have my communication graph, and from the email addresses, I would want to figure out the kind of individuals or the nodes in the graph. And of course, multiple emails can map to the same individual. Actually, the annoying thing that you'll find in some email data sets is people actually share emails, and sometimes you have to split them. So you do this. Then for link prediction, again, it can be predicting different kind of social links in the graph. And then finally, for the last one, for doing node labeling or collective classification, maybe you're trying to figure out the role of the individual in the organization. So you're trying to label these nodes with what kind of person they are. Okay, so the thing that's challenging about this is when you put all of them together, they're all clearly interdependent. As I figure out what nodes I have, that's going to impact what edges I have and the labels on them and so on. So it's a challenging and I think interesting kind of problem. So what are some key ideas that go into solving these types of problems? The things I think really are universal for data science when you're dealing with this kind of structured data. The first one is something that we've seen talked about already, the importance of feature engineering. And this can be the key to the success of a machine learning algorithm. In some settings, you don't have information, but in a lot of settings, you actually do have
domain information. You have some knowledge about the data schema. You have some knowledge about the knowledge representation that's been used to talk about the entities and the relationships. And so it makes a lot of sense to, you know, make use of that when you're defining features. And I really think that this is a place where it brings together a lot of interesting ideas from databases, AI, and machine learning. And there's a real opportunity to do foundational work here. A lot of times it's kind of put to the side and you say, oh, you know, feature engineering, we know it's important, but we don't really have a science for it. I think we really need to be able to develop a science for it. So, the next key idea is something that was in the title of the talk, and I hope I kind of hinted at that already in the micro patterns, which is the need for collectively reasoning. And so I'm going to go back to the example where I'm trying to infer the labels for a node in a network, so what their political persuasion is. And clearly here, I would want to make use of whatever local information I have. So if I know something about, you know, what campaign they contribute to, I certainly should make use of that. And so I can have a feature, and, you know, I'm going to unpack what this means in a few slides, but I can have a feature that says if they donate to a particular party, they're more likely to vote for a particular party. I can also have kind of local features that make use of their status updates, their tweets, and so on, and, you know, see if they mention some particular loaded word in it, and again, give some weight. But this is just a indication, a feature that says maybe they're more likely to do this. And the relative weights have some implication here. But having done that, having used all the local information I can to infer the label for a node, then I'm going to look at the whole network. And I have some labels given. And in these kinds of settings, making use of the relationships between the unknown labels and the labeled nodes is important. So I can say something like, well, if my friend's likely to vote for a particular party, I'm more likely to. Or, you know, if my spouse is going to vote for a party, then I'm even more likely to. And the key thing is we want to do this so that we end up jointly inferring the unknown labels here. So I'm not going to predict each one independently, even though I just showed the animation that made it look like I was doing each one independently. I want to, you know, jointly find the assignments for the unknowns that's going to maximize some probability of the labeling. So there's a lot of challenges in doing this, but the big thing in doing this kind of collective reasoning is you have this dependency of the outputs on each other, and being able to build probabilistic models that capture these dependencies is hugely important, and it ends up resulting in really, really large, really loopy graphs, and those are the ones that are known to be particularly challenging to deal with. And again, this is a place where there's opportunities, I think, for lots of cool research. And then the last key idea that I want to mention is, and this goes by different names, but I'm going to use the term lifted model, where when you're dealing with graphs and you're reasoning about these dependencies, oftentimes you have kind of repeated patterns of dependence. And so the simplest example, and the one that you guys are, I'm sure, all familiar with, is HMM, where HMM, you have this repeated dependence of time t plus 1 on time t. But now you have this rich graph structure. How do you encode things like that where you say, okay, the way that this individual depends on your neighbor is similar, and how do I propagate all that? There's been quite a line of work in
involved in this general area. We have a survey that tries to cover a bunch of it. But the kind of takeaways, especially for this audience, if you're not familiar with graphical models with tied parameters or so on, I think that's intuitive to deep learning folks what that would mean, is you have fewer parameters, you have better learning and generalization. And then the cool thing is, in some cases, you can make the learning much faster because you can do smart caching and reuse the inferences. So again, this is an opportunity. So the last thing that I want to mention is some tools for doing this. So we have a particular tool that we're developing in my research group called probabilistic soft logic. Normally in a talk, you know, as a good academic, this would be where I would dive into the hour-long talk on what it is, given the time and so on. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to try and give it to you in one slide, and then maybe cheat and give you another slide or two afterwards. But the key thing is, it's open source toolkit. There's videos available. The URL is up here. The big thing is a declarative probabilistic programming language for defining a certain class of graphical models on richly structured graph data. So it fits all of these example problems that I have been proposing. And then the other really important thing is that doing math inference, or finding the most probable assignment to all of the unknowns, where the unknowns can represent these link predictions and node labels and so on, is actually a convex optimization problem. So inference is really fast. We can further speed this up with smart optimization and so on. It outperforms discrete MRFs in speed by orders of magnitude, and often also accuracy. And it's flexible, so we've used it to do a variety of different problems: activity recognition, stance detections, sentiment analysis, drug target prediction, engagement modeling in MOOCs, and so on. And we're looking for more. So if you have a problem that you think might fit this, we're very happy to talk to you. And it's open source, code, data, tutorials are available. So especially for this audience, you're kind of like, okay, well, give me a little bit more than that, right? So first off, what does it look like? Those things that I wrote up here, those are actually PSL rules. They're defining potential functions, and potential functions then go into graphical model. That graphical model has this general form, so it's a conditional random field, and the smarts go into that loss function there. And that loss function is a hinge loss, so we call it a hinge loss Markov random field. And the cool thing, and I think the really beautiful thing, is we kind of derive the same optimization through three very different interpretations for the random variables. So one interpretation is just an LP program for MaxSat that has approximation guarantees. Another is a pseudo-marginal relaxation for Boolean Markov random fields. And then third, and where the name soft comes from, is a form of kind of logic for reasoning about continuous values, where the continuous values can be a degree of truth. So this makes it all very flexible. And so again, here's a pointer. And to summarize, I think we really need kind of methods that can deal with the structure in the data. So when I say graphs, I'm thinking richly structured graphs. And I think there's opportunities for new theory and algorithms for these kinds of models that do take into account structure. And then, of course, connecting those to the kinds of models where they're inferring the structure from the data. And then many of the upcoming opportunities in AI are exactly at this boundary of mixing structure and unstructured data. So, thanks.